And we are honored today to have a guest with us to speak on this next bill. Let's start with explanation of the bill, and that'll be House Bill 2014, and Emily will present the bill.
Mr. Chair, members, House Bill 2014 allows individuals and corporations to subtract from the Arizona gross income any capital gains and add any lost capital losses derived from the exchange of different forms of legal tender beginning in tax year 2018. HB 2014 defines legal tender as a medium of exchange, including specie, that is authorized by the U.S. Constitution or Congress for the payment of debts, public charges, taxes, and dues, defines specie as coins that have precious metal content. Currently in Arizona, long-term and short-term capital gains purchased before 2012 are taxed as regular income, and any long-term capital gains for assets purchased in 2012 and after are taxed at a reduced rate of 25% from tax year 2015 and thereafter. With that, I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. Members, any questions for Emily? Thank you very much. I believe we have the sponsor of the bill here, Representative Finchem, and if you'd like to say a word or two.
Thank you very much, Chairman, members. I think I'm going to start with, if you don't mind, I believe you have a paper handout. Did that go out, Chairman? Okay, I'll dispense with the PowerPoint presentation then. The first thing that I want to do is open with, when this Morgan silver dollar was minted by the U.S. government, it was a dollar. $1. Okay? Today, this same coin is equal to $20. And I think that we have all since childhood heard about the idea of inflation. What the IRS has figured out at the federal level is how to tax inflation as a gain. They call it capital gains because they want to say that you buy this with this. The truth couldn't be any further than away from that position. This is an exchange of one type of currency for another. So what this bill seeks to do, and I'm not going to belabor the point because I'd like to get to our guest who would like to talk to Honest Money. Basically, it allows for, we remove, at least in the state of Arizona, the taxable feature of exchanges of one type of currency for another. Now, you may hear something from Department of Revenue that this is very difficult to do, but at the end of the day, we are the policy setting body. And when the mechanics of money come in conflict with the mechanics of government, yes, they're going to butt heads. But I think that we've got a grand opportunity in this case to at least protect at some small level the opportunity for Arizona residents to protect their investment. Actually, it's a conversion of one type of currency for another because of a lack of trust. Now, one of the things that I'd like to call your attention to in that document that I have sent to you is the idea that there's been this quiet theft going on over time. You'll notice the document that has a house, has eggs, has hard money, and then has fiat currency. I find it interesting that in 1957, a 1,600 square foot house would cost roughly the equivalent of 37,700 eggs, which would be 13,500 silver dollars. Which, in that day, would have been 13,500 silver certificates. Now, today we move forward to, and this is just 2007 because it's when this was prepared, that same house would still cost the equivalent of 37,700 eggs. And it would still be roughly 13,500 silver dollars. However, in Federal Reserve notes, it would be $175,000. That's called inflation. So when somebody takes that $13,500 in silver dollars and exchanges them for Federal Reserve notes, the IRS says that that's a taxable event. But that's the exact same organization that is charged with responsibility for supporting the value of currency. Currency meaning the paper Federal Reserve note. Now, the last thing that I'll mention is that on this what we call dollar bill. The very top, it says Federal Reserve note. I'm a real estate agent, so let me put this in real estate terms, because I know just about everybody here should have a house. If you don't, I would be happy to talk to you about it. When you purchase a house, unless you pay cash for that house, you have a deed of trust, which is evidence that you have ownership, fee simple ownership in that property, that real property, and you have a note, that your purchase property note. That is the evidence of the loan, which by way of definition, a note is an evidence of debt. So what we're really doing is we're trading thin slices that are evidence of debt daily, pretending that it's money. And until you extinguish this debt with the exchange for something that is real, you are the carrier of the debt of the federal government. So to assume that you have been carrying the debt for the federal government for however long and move that into real property, that you should suffer a tax consequence for that exchange of currency authorized by the U.S. Constitution, minted by the U.S. Mint, or printed by the Federal Reserve, until you extinguish that debt, you remain the carrier of debt. So with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions that you might have.
Members, any questions for the sponsor? Thank you very much. Apparently you did an excellent job.
Thank you.
Appreciate that. And I just want to make a comment before we move forward that I am very supportive of this bill. Each of us sponsored a bill last year, and we know that here in Arizona we've been trying to get this done for a number of years, and our bills have been vetoed by the governor how many times now? Three times, four times, something like that. We lost track. But thank you so much for bringing this bill, and appreciate your work on it.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
All right. We have a very special guest here who now we do have him signed in. And Dr. Ron Paul is a former 12-term congressman and candidate for president of the United States and physician. He is also the nation's leading voice for limited government, individual liberty, and sound money. Since leaving Congress in 2013, Dr. Paul has kept busy with the Campaign for Liberty, the Ron Paul Institute, and his daily online Liberty Report. And I know this is, we said very little, we could go on for an hour, but we'd rather listen to you. Welcome, Dr. Ron Paul. We appreciate you being here.
Mr. Chairman and panel, I want to thank you very much for the opportunity to come here to visit, because I consider what you're doing is very important, not only for your state and for the issue of money, but for an understanding about some of our problems in this country. And it's an issue that I have worked on for a long time. Matter of fact, it was in 1971 when we sort of deserted all monetary sense with the breakdown of the Bretton Woods and just separating the dollar completely from gold is when I got interested in talking about economic policy. So I'm delighted to be able to come here and visit with you a bit, and I really want to congratulate you for this, because I think of this in a couple terms. You know, in Washington, one of my biggest complaints in Washington was the complaint with Congress. I was a member, but I was complaining because they were always delivering the prerogatives, the responsibilities to somebody else, to the bureaucrats, to international organization, and they would give it to the executive branch, and they never accepted their responsibility. On the monetary issues, the states are talked about in the Constitution, and they have restrictions. They can't print money, but they also have been told in the Constitution that they can only use gold and silver as legal tender. So the responsibility is on the states to follow the rules, and that meant nobody was supposed to use anything other than silver, gold, and gold as legal tender. But we've had a mess. It's gotten worse. It started in 1913. There was a sort of a climactic end in 1971, but the problems have continued, and if you look at some of the charts, things have been really rocky since 71. With the destruction of the value of the money. Since 1971, we've lost 95% of the value of the dollar. And The tragedy there is that the average person, the middle class, gets wiped out. Austrian economics teaches that if you destroy the currency, you will destroy the middle class, and people who will get the money that the government prints, which they shouldn't be allowed to do, goes into the pockets of the bankers and the corporations. And when the people get the money, their prices go up, and they wonder why they're getting behind. Well, my wages went up $5, $10. No, they need to be $15, but they're looking in the wrong place. It's the monetary issue, and that it is the real problem. So what you're doing here, the way I understand it, is you're suggesting that maybe we ought not to tax money. And I think that's a good idea, because I'd like to not tax a lot of things, but certainly it makes no sense to tax money. And that is what I understand you're trying to stop, because, you know, if you have currency transactions across the world, they don't measure the value of the dollar. Oh, your dollar value went up, so we're going to tax you on the increase of your value. So, no, you don't get taxed for that. So the tax issue has been used. Matter of fact, the very early history was they used the tax issue to more or less justify the Second National Bank, which got us off on the wrong track because they called it a tax issue rather than a monetary issue. But very explicitly, the Congress is allowed to coin money. One time in a banking committee hearing, they were arguing the case that in the Constitution, they were given the authority to print money at will. And I wrote in my dissenting view that show me, it says you're not allowed to coin money, but they just did that. They came to believe that they had the authority to print money. They don't have the authority to print money. And the states can only use silver and gold as legal tender. And in Article 10, where they mention that you can only use gold and silver, the very next sentence is you can't counterfeit the securities or the coin of the United States. And I often wondered if we'd have ever enforced the law of the 1792, the very first Coinage Act. It said that anybody that did commit counterfeit could get the death penalty. And I often thought, boy, I don't know if they'll ever get around to enforcing that. That'd be a lot of problems. But that's how seriously they felt about this, because they had the runaway inflation with the continental dollar. And subsequently, they tried to keep the central banks out. Jefferson got rid of the first central bank, and Jackson got rid of the second national bank, and we're waiting on the third one to fall. But it's the issue of money, and I think this tax issue is very important. I like the idea of competing currencies, and in my ideas about getting back to normal, you probably can't turn a switch under today's conditions and say, well, tomorrow it's going to be like the old days. It doesn't work. But you could move gradually back if you have competing currencies. So I've often introduced legislation for competing currencies, and what you're doing here would be very helpful. It would be legalizing competition in a constitutional fashion. It isn't like saying, okay, Arizona wants to print their paper currency again, because you're not allowed to do that, but you're allowed to try to make it competitive. And I think this is very important. I think it's important for what you're doing. It's an important issue. It could help your state, and there's a lot of benefits. But to me, since I'm in the education business as much as the political business, I think what you're doing here is just great. I think if this passes, people are going to know about this. Other states are already involved. There's going to be a lot more. So this is where the responsibility of government ought to be. I like the idea to come to a state legislative body, because I think the authority should be here with the states, not at the federal level. Their job is to mess things up. And your job at the state level is to try to clean up the mess. But this would be historic, and it'll be noticed. It'll be a good step in the right direction. And I am very pleased with what's been happening, because in the 1970s, I was motivated by the breakdown of the gold standard in 1971. If anybody remembers the 70s, we had interest rates at 21%, inflation rate of 15%. And I thought the monetary issue was important, because it is the monetary debasement that allows governments, federal governments, to spend more money than they have. have, and they print it, then they can have a welfare warfare state and no responsibility. So that's what fascinated me about the monetary issue. And I think that there'll come a day when it's absolutely necessary that we do it. Conditions will get so bad. So the more understanding there is, I am always delighted when so many young people are interested in this issue, because many young people will be inheriting this problem and trying to sort it out. But it's really not too difficult. It isn't something because Ron Paul likes the gold standard. Believe me, the gold standard was invented a long, long time ago, from the beginning of recorded history. 5,000 years ago, they used gold and silver. Biblically, gold and silver, real weights and measures. That's what they counted by. So this is not brand new. It's the governments and the people who seek power are always undermining the restraints placed on governments by honest money. So I congratulate you for hearing and dealing with this bill, because I think if you do pass this bill, it will be a great step forward for a lot of people to understand the money issue and the freedom issue. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Paul. Before you leave the podium, members, are there questions for Dr. Paul? Senator Farley, now be nice.
I'm always nice, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Mr. Congressman, for being here, and thank you for your service, your lifetime of service. I really respect your commitment. I also, as a graphic designer, really loved your Revolution logo. I thought that was brilliant. I'm trying to wrap my mind around how this isn't simply another tax giveaway to people who are coin collectors. The problem I see is that I get your point about you don't tax money when you exchange money for money. And I would buy that if the $20 gold piece from 1850 was going to be traded for a $20 bill. Then you don't tax that, because that's what happens when you got a gold coin that says a face value of $20. It should be worth $20. It's always worth $20. When you got a $20 bill that's worth $20, it's always worth $20. When you actually trade money, paper money, no one gives you less because it's all balled up and torn and all the rest of it. But if you trade a $20 gold coin for money, then you get a lot less if it's in bad shape. To me, the value of a gold coin, silver coin, all the rest of that stuff is worth based on a combination of how much of the precious metal is in it, what combination, what condition it's in, and whether or not there's a big market for that particular coin. So it becomes more of a collector thing. So to give someone a capital gains tax break on the money they make in money that you would call dishonest money from selling that coin seems like just simply a tax giveaway that other people will be paying for, because we're going to need to get enough money to pay for our roads and schools anyway.
Well, I think it is returning some real value that somebody accumulated, because what they bought increased in value. But you say if you have a $20 gold piece and you turn it for $20, there should not be a tax. Probably wouldn't be. But what if you turn in your $20 gold piece and you get $150? The government said, because the value of the dollar goes down, they're taxing inflation. So that's very unfair. And numismatic coins also go up, not only because they're old, and there will always be numismatic values going up, which people should be rewarded for because they have studied it and pick and choose the coins. But if a numismatic coin goes up and is very expensive, that's one of the first places people go to try to protect themselves against the debasement of currency. So that value, once again, it's inflation. You're taxing inflation and everything that goes up. This is why they have to adjust the tax code, because if you go up to the next bracket, you know, you pay a higher tax and this sort of thing. It's so unfair not to have a standard of value. By not having this standard of value, which is so important, is sort of trying to build a building with a ruler that's always changing value. So you want something that you can always define, and that's why gold and silver 5,000 years ago was used as a standard, and it's established as a sound value, and why paper money always fails. So I think what you want is honesty and standards, and I think it takes care of this business of things going up in value and why shouldn't they pay taxes on it. Well, why does the government need the money? money is the big question. They don't need the amount of money they're taking anyway. But I imagine that there's not a whole lot of taxes involved in numismatic coins, but I don't know. I've never looked at that figure. But I would, I think that's a, what you're talking about is you're taxing inflation. So the more you inflate, if you get 20 $20 bills or something, the government's going to get more money, you know, by doing this.
But Mr.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Chair Congressman Paul. Just a second.
Senator Farley, I guess Senator Farley has one more question for you, if you don't mind.
Thank you, sir. I guess there's a lot of places where people can decide to invest their money as a hedge against inflation.
Right.
That's why we invest money. You can invest it in stocks. You can invest it in the real estate, your house, a lot of other things. And that also goes way up in value over time, and that represents in at least some part inflation. But people will be taxed on capital gains for that stuff. This bill will only exempt from capital gains the collection of this, the sale of gold and silver coins. So to me, that's picking winners and losers. The people who decide to invest in gold and silver coins won't be taxed. The people who decide to invest in the stock market or real estate will be taxed.
Yeah, I understand your point, but the important point is stocks are not money, and gold and silver is money. Money is different than stocks and bonds, and money's been different, and you shouldn't have to tax money, you know, just because of you have to defend that the fact if this year, you know, the dollar goes up and down, it went up 20% in the last year or so. So you, the dollars that you kept in your suitcase at home all of a sudden went up 20%. You want the government to come in and say, my paper money went up 20%, so I have to pay capital gains tax on it? No, you want everybody to be treated equally. And actually, paper, Federal Reserve, is not money. It's a substitute for money, and it's fraud. And they're really messing up the people by using the tax code to tax this fraudulent money where there shouldn't be a tax at all. And this is the reason why it has to be treated as money. You have to understand the issue of money, and money should be exempt from taxation. Like you said, the dollar may be very stable, you know, in value. It's the other half that's at fault, and that's where the other half is getting taxed. And it's not very fair to the people, or it's not fair to the Constitution. It's not fair to the founders. It's not fair to those who have warned us. The founders knew about the runaway inflation of the continental money, and they say they had a vote in the Continental Congress to allow Congress to print money, and it was defeated. They don't want people printing money, and here we have a tax code all based on accumulating more money for the government through this tax code. And you say, well, we won't have enough money to do these good things that we're going to do. Well, tax people more honestly, tax people outrightly. Then maybe if we had to pay for our bills, maybe we'd be less involved overseas. Maybe we would have a smaller welfare state, and maybe we wouldn't, but people would have to pay. So this is very deceitful, what's happening. It's a hidden tax, and inflation is a tax, so this is the reason the monetary issue is so important to me, because ultimately, if you want to protect liberty and the size of government, you have to have honest money.
Thank you very much, Dr. Paul. We appreciate that. Senator Borelli has a question.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and Dr. Paul, welcome, and I'm glad to finally have met you. So would you agree that when 1971, when President Nixon, when we went off the gold, so this actually might help convince Senator Farley on this one, when President Nixon took us off the gold standard in 71, the price of gold was at 70, it was at 35 bucks, and then in 1980, but in 10 years, it was up at 800. So would you agree that this was government-induced inflation?
Nobody else, but they had already inflated. It was the adjustment for the inflation prior to that. There was too many dollars floating around, and we couldn't maintain it. So we declared a bankruptcy. We were out of gold. We had promised people that they could repatriate their dollar. Not Americans. You were denied that right in 1933. So that was another abuse. But up until then, a foreigner could. We got angry at de Gaulle because he knew what was coming. He was turning in billions and millions of dollars and repatriating his gold. gold at $35 an ounce. And finally, they ran out of gold. But the reason the gold standard broke down is we had so much paper out there. And guess what? We have trillions and trillions of dollars more now. So we're actually facing a greater crisis here in the next decade, I'm sure, for the adjustment that always comes. The markets are more powerful than the politicians and the bureaucrats, the banking system. The markets usually rule ultimately, although there's a lot of adjustments and a lot of shenanigans that go on in the meantime.
Thank you very much. Any other questions? Appreciate you being here and traveling so far.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor.
Okay. I think next let's call up Dr. Keith Weiner. I know Dr. Weiner has been working on this subject for a long time. He, in my opinion, he's an expert in this field, and we're glad you're here.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members. So first of all, I wanted to...
For the record, state your name, please.
Keith Weiner. I'm an economist. I'm the president of the Gold Standard Institute, USA, and also the CEO of a company called Monetary Metals. I had a partial answer for Senator Farley's question earlier. I don't believe this bill exempts from tax numismatic value. I believe it's only bullion that is exempted. So if there's an 1872 coin that's worth $20 million, I don't believe this bill exempts that from tax. I could be wrong on that, but from my reading. I wanted to just make a very brief remark, riffing off of something that Representative Finchem said when he was talking about exchange of one form of money for another. It's a truism in economics that when you tax something, you get less of it. So many years ago, I had a client in a previous business based in Denmark, and we were talking about cars. Now, this was the late 1990s, I had a 1995 Camaro for which I paid $19,000. And he was talking about, in Denmark, most people don't have cars, because the tax rate on cars was 180%. So he personally had a very modest 15-year-old economy, you know, Japanese car of some sort, for which he paid like the equivalent of $42,000 at the time. So the more you tax something, the less of it you get. So the question that is hanging over this proceeding is, if you tax the exchange of gold for paper Federal Reserve notes, what is it you get less of? You don't get less gold. The gold has been around and been in human hands and been valued as money for at least thousands of years, if not longer than that. What is it you get less of? You get less exchange. So for example, let's say somebody bought gold in the 1990s when the price was $300 an ounce. Now today they've got a great business opportunity. And they're thinking about investing in this business, which is going to bring jobs and not to mention tax revenues to the state of Arizona. It's going to occupy real estate. It's going to do all the things for which presumably all of us stand. And you're looking at, you bought this at $300. To make the math easy, the price of gold today is about $1,200. You're looking at $900 an ounce in capital gains. Now at the federal level, that's taxed at 28%. Add some more for the state level, which is what we're talking about here. Let's, to make the math easy, let's assume it's one-third tax. So of that $900 an ounce, of what they call a gain, you're looking at a $300 an ounce tax actually payable to Arizona and to the U.S. government. That might be enough, and very often, in fact, it is enough, that the person will say, I'm not making the business investment. So what the tax does is it doesn't prevent people from buying the gold. If you go to a federalreserve.gov website, they talk about their policy target for the dollar is 2% debasement per year. As we all know, over the past 8 or 9 years, they've been trying really, really, really hard, taking some pretty crazy, unprecedented measures to try to get the dollar to go down at their rate, and they've kind of been not exactly hitting it. Well, there's a risk that they overshoot, and that's why people choose to protect themselves, not to get a gain in gold, but to simply avoid the loss in dollars. So if somebody has done that, if they've chosen to avoid the losses in the dollar that have already occurred, and let alone the bigger loss to come, and now they're considering a business investment, what that tax does is you will get less exchange. And it's that exchange that's not producing much revenue for the state of Arizona. based on my very informal discussions with a couple of other states, Texas and Indiana, the revenue to the state of Arizona on this tax is de minimis. In Texas, it was $300,000 a year. State of Arizona being much smaller, it might be $100,000 or $50,000 is what the state is getting in revenue from that, so it's nothing. But what is the state giving up in terms of business creation, job creation, and yes, tax revenue creation by preventing that exchange of Federal Reserve notes and gold? It's very hard to answer that question, but economics tells us the answer is it's probably a big number. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Members. Excellent. Thank you very much. Members, questions for Dr. Wiener? Senator Peterson.
And I don't know, this may be a question for DOR. So if just on tax issues, assuming, let's say I buy something, I had bought something in the 1930s. I can't remember the value of it that I paid for it. How do people deal with that on the tax, as far as the tax implications go?
What I think happens at the small scale is people just don't pay the tax. It's just like if you go shopping in the state of Nevada and then you bring it back into Arizona, you're supposed to report it to the Department of Revenue. I think most people don't, and I think that's what happens at the small scale with gold and silver. Somebody pays in silver or whatever, they're supposed to pay a tax on it. They probably just don't, and that's one of the reasons why the tax revenues raised from this are pretty small.
Again, well, I imagine it's all to that point, Mr. Chair. I imagine there's also, you know, the currency fluctuates, and so you're going to have losses, and they pretty much just offset the gains. And so, anyways.
Thank you very much, Dr. Wiener. I appreciate your testimony. And with that, we've had some fun here. We've enjoyed ourselves. However, we do have 14 more bills, and so we're going to have to get serious here. So we're going to ask the people who come to testify to limit themselves to 2 minutes, if they would, please, and because we really need to be finished by noon, and time is moving on. So who next do we have?
Chairman, we have F. Thomas Feidler.
Mr. Feidler. Is he here? There he is.
There he is.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members, for allowing me to speak. My name is Tom Feidler. I live in Legislative District 24, and I wanted to address something specific about Representative Finchem's bill, and that is by focusing on the capital gains tax for specifically what we call money. We can determine what revenue would be lost. And this was what I've heard the vetoing governors and members of this this committee and the committee in the House also were asking, how much is this going to cost? Well, we know how much it costs. Dr. Wiener referred to it a little bit. He said, maybe 300,000, you know. We have an organization called the Arizona Constitutional Advocates, and we posed this question to Treasurer Ducey: what revenue would be lost? And thinking he would be treasurer, he would have access to this information. We got no response. So my conclusion is the reason we didn't get a response was either that it was insignificant or it couldn't be segregated from all other capital gains. So that's my point. Thank you.
Very good. Members, any questions? Thank you very much for your testimony.
Thank you very much. We have Greg Shepherd next. Mr. Shepherd, are you here?
There he is. And if you'd... when you get to the podium, if you would state your name for the record, we'd appreciate it. And thank you for being here.
Greg Shepherd, Inchia. I come to you from the Navajo Nation, Yat-e-Habena. I traveled all the way across the state because I believe this issue that we're dealing with here today is just vitally important. And it affects our very freedom as human beings. Over the past 40 years, since I began my practice of Aikido in my early 20s, I've spent a lot of time and energy focusing on, you know, what is energy? Who are the entities that control us? Who have taken over the power centers on the planet? And how do they control us? And this thing we call currency is a very effective way that we are being controlled. And the Federal Reserve, established in 1913, it was kind of a coup d'etat, and in effect they took over how they control us in the money system. And gosh, there's just so much to monetary history that was briefly mentioned here. Like in 1971, it was raised that that's when President Nixon closed the gold window. Yes, I have my little stopwatch here. And from that time, the U.S. dollar became a fiat currency, meaning backed by nothing real other than our military. And all fiat currencies, there have been thousands of them across the planet, and every single one of them has ended very badly. The average lifespan of a fiat currency is about 40 years, and we're going on 46 years. So, with my remaining 10 seconds, I just want to thank you folks for representing us, Arizona citizens, and doing the right thing and returning toward an honest currency system in the United States. It's tremendously important, and this bill is a small step in the right direction. So,
thank you very much for your testimony. Any questions for Thomas? Thank you for being here and for traveling so far. We appreciate it.
Next up, we have Douglas Arndt, A-R-D-T.
Thank you for being here.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members. I want to speak to a couple of points that were previously alluded to.
If you'd state your name for the record, please.
Doug Arndt, representing the Republican Precinct Committee from Gila County. And that's ranching territory, and people understand the value of their hard-earned wealth transferred into other means for preservation of that wealth, as was already mentioned. But I want to speak particularly to Dr. Paul's mention about the Second National Bank. This was started by Congress as a means to put the government's money, the national government's money, somewhere. They had to have pay their bills. And so Maryland happened to be a branch where they had used their money and supported and floated some bank notes based on 100% redeemable currency in silver or gold. So when the government transacted business, in essence, this Second National Bank had an unfair advantage to the state banks, and the state banks became jealous, especially when a lot of them went under in the unfortunate and unnecessary recession of 1918. So what happened was the courts awarded, I should say Maryland sued for taxes that the bank wouldn't pay. The bank turned around and appealed all the way to the Supreme Court, and in a unanimous decision, the Supreme Court sided with the people whose money was being reflected as value in the bank. And in essence, Justice Marshall said that they ruled that the bank was constitutional and the Maryland tax was unconstitutional. The court ruled that Maryland lacked the power to tax the bank because, pursuant to the Supremacy Clause, the laws of the state trump, in this case, a convicting state law. So in essence, what Marshall's reasoning was that you can't tax the people's money because it's just a storehouse of value. If this bill were to be challenged all the way to the Supreme Court, I don't think they would have standing, because the Supreme Court today would simply say this has already been ruled on. And in answer to Senator Farley's concerns, suppose that a constituent of his in very hard times was down to their last pieces of value. They have a shovel and a hungry crying baby and grandfather's numismatic coin, a gold $20 piece. And they have to provide food for that baby, and that baby doesn't care about anything except its hunger pains. Who do you think is going to give more value to, the shovel in exchange for some baby food or to a $20 gold piece? And the underlying decision today here is we can't tax and force constituents to take food out of the baby's mouth to pay the state of Arizona when the Supreme Court has already said no.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions from members?
Next,
thank you.
Next up, we have Mr. Jerry Klingman.
My name is Jerry Klingman, LD 16 chairman, and after the great speakers we have today, I have nothing to add. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate that very much.
Thank you for being here, Jerry.
And then, if necessary, Sean Lau from the Arizona Department of Revenue or Matt Papke.
Any members?
Can I just ask Mr. Locks a question?
Yes.
Mr. Locks, we have a question for you up here, please.
Looks like that's all.
While you're coming up, Mr. Locks, just if you could, I had a question earlier about assuming I purchased some coins in 1930, now I sell them. And I can't remember what I paid for them. How are those situations dealt with?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. For the record, I'm Sean Laux, the Chief Legislative Liaison with the Arizona Department of Revenue. Mr. Chairman, Senator Peterson, I think it depends. For Arizona purposes, we would follow, the Internal Revenue Code and whatever the feds might say. I imagine that they have ways under audit to determine or to make a determination what potentially the value was during that time, if it was found out that those gains were not reported. And it may be that there could be some sort of estimate that one could make if there were a gain that a taxpayer would report federally.
And then just one last question, Mr. Chair. Mr. Knox, as far as ratio of who's paying these taxes, businesses or dealers to private individuals, do you have any idea what we're looking at, what that ratio would be?
Mr. Chairman, Senator Peterson, I don't know. The dealers, that's generally considered ordinary income, and so it wouldn't be subject
to that.
This would just simply be the outside of that.
Okay. Thank you.
Senator Farley.
Chair, one more question, Mr. Laux. In your reading of the bill, did you see any exemption for the you would still be able to tax the numismatic value increase?
Mr. Chairman, Senator Farling, our interpretation of the bill is that as long as it's a coin with precious metal in it and it's sold, regardless of the value attributed, then that would be exempt. So if you had some sort of historical misprint or anything like that, it would not be subject to capital gains for Arizona purposes.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Appreciate that. I believe we have no one else signed up to speak.
Yes,
I would like to mention that if you sign up to request to speak, we see your names here. I want to mention there are, in addition to the people who have spoken, we have 40 people signed up in favor of the bill, not requesting to speak. We appreciate that, but I want you to, those who have signed up, I want you to know that it is very valuable to sign up in favor or opposed. We have no one signed up opposed to this bill today. Really appreciate the input from people and just want to reaffirm the fact that this request to speak system works very well. We have a chance to see the messages you've given. And so please tell your friends and neighbors that there is a way they can participate in the legislature and have an influence. It definitely has an effect. So, thank you. Since we have no more...
Senator Borelli.
Yes.
Senator Borelli, comment?
No.
Comment or question?
I actually have a question for the sponsor, just a follow-up.
Okay. Sponsor's still here. If you don't mind coming up, Representative Finchem.
And for the sake of time, I'll ask the question while he's walking up. We've heard a lot of statements like we're purchasing gold, we're purchasing coins. Are we purchasing a coin? I mean, it's money. How do we purchase money? Or is this a different misconception?
Mr. Chairman, Senator Borelli, actually that's a very astute observation. You're not purchasing money. It's an exchange. U.S. Mint controls not only the coin that has been coined, but also the Federal Reserve notes that flow through the system. So at the time that you trade, for lack of a better word, you trade Federal Reserve notes for something of the U.S. government, for something that is of the U.S. government, which is maybe a gold coin. Now, a lot of this, quite frankly, would be averted if the U.S. Mint would stop printing $1 or $20 on a gold or silver piece and just print 0.999 pure 1 ounce. Of course, then it'd have to be 0.999 pure and not mixed with other base metals. But I think your observation is exactly right. This is not a purchase. This is an exchange of one type of currency for another.
Thank you very much. Any other questions? Then, Madam Secretary, please move the bill.
I move House Bill 2014, receive a due pass recommendation.
Thank you. There are no amendments. If there's no further discussion, seeing none, Madam Secretary, please call the roll.
Senator Borelli?
Aye.
No.
Mr. Chair, I explain my vote.
Senator Farley.
Thank you. I did some research, and I don't see any exception for numismatic value as being an exception from this exemption. This is simply if someone buys a $20 gold or sells a $20 gold piece and gets $3,000 for it. They bought it originally for $20, then they will be they will be exempt from tax on the $2,880 that they gained from it. That is no different. That sort of investment decision is no different from any other investment decision people make, whether they're buying stocks, whether they're buying real estate, whether they're buying anything else. So what we are doing in effect is giving a massive tax advantage to people who are coin collectors. And this is the biggest, strongest example I could ever see of people picking winners and losers. If we're saying that you don't pay taxes if you invest in gold and silver coins, but you do pay taxes if you invest in real estate or stocks, then that's giving a huge advantage to this market for people who are going to collect coins. And I don't see any public policy reason to do that. Gold and silver may be considered real money by many people. Paper money is considered real money by most people because that's what we get paid in most of the time. And the declaration of something of having value is something that is determines whatever the buyer determines has value. It's part of what the free market is. If we were trading a $20 gold piece for a $20 bill, then there shouldn't be any taxes available on it, and there isn't. It's already built in that way. When we trade a $20 bill for a $20 bill, nobody sees any change in value depending on what bad condition that $20 bill is, but that's not the case in the case of this money. I don't see any purpose for us to be able to give a special tax advantage to coin collectors as an investment vehicle. It doesn't help in a public policy perspective. And that's when it comes down to it. You take all the talk about the value of money and everything else philosophically aside, that's what this bill does. So I'm voting no.
Mr. Chair.
Senator Peterson.
What an honor to have Dr. Ron Paul here today with us in committee. Thank you, Mr. Finchem, for bringing this bill. Wow, you know, every once in a while you're down at the Capitol and you just realize this is a special day. We're doing something amazing. As I read the heading of the bill, it says legal tender exchange. Dr. Ron Paul is right. This is a tax on inflation. So, you know, he's given us a lot of advice over the years. He's been a champion of freedom and liberty. If we would have listened to him, our country would be in much better shape. Unfortunately, I've never been down in Congress where I could vote with him, or fortunately, maybe fortunately. But today I get to vote with Dr. Ron Paul. And Mr. Chair, I vote aye.
Aye.
Aye. Members, by your vote of four ayes, three noes, and zero not voting, you have given House Bill 2014 a do pass recommendation.
I'll never forget my past, and I hope you value this coin as much as I value you and what you've done for this country. And hope you.
That's very nice.
This may not be worth but $5, but it's worth a lot to me. And I hope you cherish this friendship.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you,
sir.
Thank you.
Is it okay if I send it in Tobin over there? Okay.
Good job, Dr. Paul.
Thank you.
Captain Paul.
Thank you very much. And we have another doctor in the House, Mr. Finchem.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Yes, we do have another doctor in the House. It is my distinct honor and pleasure, probably one of the greatest days of my life, to introduce Dr. Ron Paul, 12-term congressman in the U.S. Congress. Dr. Paul came to Phoenix to advocate for one of our bills over in the Senate today, which passed out of committee 4-3. So members, if you would, please welcome Ron Paul.
Dr. Paul, welcome to the Arizona House. It's a pleasure to have you here.